the church congregation.
Ricardo 李嘉杜，墨西哥人，带着美洲的热情与活力，他与台湾有着不解之缘。因为他的太太 Justin 林以文可是嫁港台湾女孩。
I like Taiwan.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's beautiful. If you know Tijuana, you will think the same thing. You're gonna say this is beautiful.
Ricardo 是一位牧师，在他的故乡美墨边境的城市 Tijuana 的红灯区里，关怀特种行业的女子，发放食物，陪伴街友，以及去育幼院陪伴孤儿等等。
¿Quieres más agua?
Ricardo 和 Justin 的工作并不简单。Tijuana 经常被套以犯罪层出、毒品泛滥等等名号，不寻常的环境造就人们如高墙一般的警戒心。要尝试突破这些人们的心防，还要小心不要越了黑帮的底线。但感动与奇迹也悄悄从中开始闪闪发亮。
朋友们你好，欢迎来到今天的真情部落格。今天我们现场的来宾哦，是从墨西哥来到台湾，而他在墨西哥的服饰呢也很特别，他专门去帮助一些在红灯区的性工作者，还有一些无家可归的街友们。今天来到节目现场来跟大家分享一下他的生命故事。 Hello Ricardo.
Hola.
Gora. Welcome to Taiwan.
Thank you.
You are from Tijuana.
Tijuana.
So what kind of place, what kind of city is Tijuana like?
It's in the highest north place of Mexico, mm-hmm. next to U.S. The first border of Mexico to U.S. It's special because everybody want to go to U.S. So they have to come to Tijuana, and sometimes they never cross to U.S. and they live a life in Tijuana.
Oh, so is Tijuana your hometown?
Yeah, I born there and I live there.
Mm-hmm. So could you share a little bit your story about how you grew up, your family background?
I'm the youngest one of five.
Five.
Yeah, it's normal in Mexico.
Yeah, right.
I grew up in a wealthy family, but when I have 7 years, my father died. For me, it's so confused because I never lose nothing in my life, like any parent or any even, I don't know, a cat, nothing. So when my father died, I don't know, understand what happened. Mm-hmm. Everybody's crying, but I don't know what's happening. Mm-hmm. After certain years later, 3 or 4 years later, I understand that what is dead is that my father never gonna come back to kiss me.
Oh.
So all my family changed. We lose all the money. We start, my mother had to work all week. Mm-hmm. I just see my mother like Saturdays and Sundays, and she come to clean us and help us like in the house. And that's pretty much my life.
So you just mentioned about that after 2 or 3 years your father passed away, you start to realize like he will never come back again. So what sort of impact did that have on you?
I'm start asking myself, where is my father? Where did he go? What is heaven? What is the hell or what is life about? So I maybe have 10 years and I'm start asking and ask my mother to bring me to the churches because I want to know what is heaven, where is my father? Mm. So she's so Catholic, we grew up so Catholic, and she bring me to all the churches. And yeah, I don't find any answer in the Catholic church. Mm. Like I try it to find where is the answer, but I feel peace when I go inside of the building. But when I go out of the building, I'm the same, confused.
So why did you keep going to church? Seems you still not find your answer.
I don't know. Maybe for tradition, because I continue to try to find the answer. And in some way, I find the answer in the Baptist church and in the church. My street is a pastor, and he knocked the door one day and he invited me to go to church. I have 13 years, mm-hmm. 13. Mm-hmm. So I go there because they play soccer, mm-hmm. and I love soccer. So I say, okay, I want to go. I don't want to go because I think God is there. It's because they're having fun with soccer. So I want to go there. And for me, I always say that Jesus is waiting for me with a soccer ball, waiting for me, like, come and join my team.
Oh, really? You know?
That's how I feel all the time, because that's why I go to the church, because play soccer, but God is waiting for me in the church. So I go to the church and everybody looks so happy. I remember that the son of my pastor, he's hugging his mother, and for me, give me so a lot of confused. Why he's hugging his mother? That's wrong, and he's doing it in the church. That's wrong, and that make me conflict. But later I see that's love. But I never receive a hug. I never can hug my mother. I can never go and say to my mother, you know, I love you. We don't have the affection. Even we are from Mexico, and that's so normal. But not in my house, because my house is a broken house. And I start asking, go to my mother. One night I remember she's sleeping, and I'm in the floor talking with her and say, like, how is my Sunday in church? And later I tell to my mom, mother, why you don't hug me? Why you don't hug my brother? He's a teenager and he have like kind of problem. He want to suicide, things like that. And I say, why you don't go and hug my brother Miguel? Like, why you don't do that? He's so sad. He needs you.
So how did she say?
And she just crying, like, she don't understand, like, why you telling me this? But like, she's so touched, like you're my youngest one. How you can speak like that, my tear, you know, like after that, my mom tried to affect, give us affect and love. It's so strange because when my mom tried to hug us, like, oh, and we're like, what are you doing? Like, what you want? We are not used to that. But I think God redeemed my family, like totally God changed the environment of my family, the hurt, the sadness, or maybe the everybody's like thinking his own life. We start to be a family after that.
When you came to know that you have a heavenly God, heavenly Father, did that heal the pain inside of you of losing your earthly father?
Yeah, it's for me, it's kind of incredible how that happened. I'm in the seventh grade. And I love to be in church. I love to be in the church. So they need someone to clean the church. And I say, like, I want to clean the church. So I go to clean the church, I don't know, every 2 days. Even I don't have to clean, I clean it. It's not going to be any service, but I want to clean everything. One day to another, they elect me to be the vice president of the youth in my state. I don't even know what's that, because for me, it's only my church and it's maybe 50 people. That's it in my world. And they tell me it's another reunion that hundreds of churches get like together. And I'm like, oh, I'm so impressed about that. I'm cleaning the church and I'm praying to God, like, oh, I want to go there and I want to serve them. The words that I remember that I tell God, I want to go and clean the tables. That's my petition to God. I don't know what's that, but it looks fun. And I want to go and clean the tables. And when I get there, the people there, the friends, they aren't even my friends. I don't know them. They don't know me too. I'm no one in that time. And they elect me like vice president for, I don't understand why reason. It's a lot of people who, they are sons of pastors, of missionaries. They're educated. They already go to university. I'm just a guy who is going to high school. And I don't talk very like Bible-y, you know, like I don't know too much the Bible.
So you were only like 16 or 17 years old?
16, 17 years, I guess, in that time.
So what were your duties as a vice president?
They don't let me do nothing. That's
the really?
Funny part. Yeah, because they're like maybe people from 25, 24 years. And I go to them and say, what you need? Did I help you? And they're, no,
you're
it's
so
okay.
Young.
It's okay. You can. The only thing they tell me to help is not a bad thing. You know, I don't blame them. If I look at me when I have 16, 17 years, maybe I think the same thing, because I look like a punk. Like I have a crazy hair. I try to do the best with the clothes that I have. So I don't look like I never had new clothes or nothing even close to here like this. And so what happened is the only thing they tell me to do, I remember, is in a camping. They tell me take the trash and put it in the trash can, like bomb. It's a big trash,
yeah.
Trashes that we have to carry like for long distance, and it's so hot and that thing smells so bad. But I say okay, so I take the trash can, and I'm so skinny that I'm more skinny than now, so I try to do it. And I remember talking to God that day. And I tell God, like, really, you call me for this? Like, you call me for be a vice president just for
trash?
Trash? and I'm not like angry. I'm just asking God. And
you
for
just
me,
feel confused, I think.
Uh-huh. That's the word, confused. And for me, I just tell to God, you know, if you call me for this, I do it.
Oh.
I put the trash. I don't care. Like, if I have to do this job that no one's want, I do it.
Your answer is, if you call me for doing this, I do it. It's not that I quit it.
No, I just say, if you call me for this, I'm in. Yeah. And next year after that, I'll be the president.
Oh, why?
I don't know why, again.
Because everyone know you?
I don't think no one knows me because I don't do nothing. I just put the trash in the... I don't know why. I really, everybody asks me the same question. I don't know why they elect me because I don't look like them. I don't dress like them. I don't talk about them. I'm not even famous. It's a lot of people who I remember. They're like, have good position. They look good. They speak good. They have like, you know, that kind of religious. They know how to do. I don't know how to do nothing. I just know how to clean. And when I be the president, everybody like run away and I'm like alone because they say, oh, I don't want to be with him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's hard.
But God used me so incredible in my first year of being president that is a kind of revival in the Baptist church in that time because that never happened. And it's funny because everybody runs and they leave me alone to do the things. And because I'm alone, I can do the things fun.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody enjoy it. Everybody, all the kids want to go to my, because it's not religious anymore. It's fun. It's their youth. They want having fun. So that's why I think I received grace from God. And I can bring and invite some groups like worship teams from different churches. In that time, in my church in particular, like you can only play piano and sing hymns. Mm-hmm. And the music, worship, and ministry, the people, they're like something so new for them. Like, they never worship God, like, with themes. They just worship with hymns. Dun, 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 dun. For the youth, that's cool. Like, it's music, it's pop, it's rock, or it's beautiful. So, I don't know, different things that God used me to break that kind of religion or tradition that the youth care.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, like, of course, I don't know what's happening. God knows his plan. But
so did you ask God?
I'm so confused. Like, I'm not worthy to that. I'm not that smart like the other people. I don't even have good clothes. I'm poor. I don't speak, like, I don't know the Bible. I just have 3 years to be saved. Why? Why they chose me to be the president? And what happened is, I'm so confused. I go to my room and I pray to God and say, like, why? Well, why you put me in this stress? All these things that I had to do. And that time is the first time that I hear the voice of God. Totally, that he tell me, because you're my son.
Mm-mm-mm-mm.
And I love you the way you are. And that's why I want to use you, because you're my son. And I'm like so confused. But why? Look at me, like, I'm not worthy to be the president. It's people who is more like intelligent, have more students than me. Why you chose me? And he say, because if I use you, they're gonna know it's me using you because you cannot do that things. And they gonna know me.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, for me, is totally healing. And he tell me, you're my son. And something inside of me like totally changed in my future, in my life, in my presence. To know that he's my father and he liked me the way I am. It's nothing wrong in me. He loves me. So I think it's my, I'm a Christian for 3 or 4 years already. That's my breakthrough. That's how I know God in the reality. Like, that changed, that night changed my life.
And you have been as a president for 5 years?
For 5 years, they elect me, elect me, elect me again.
我就看到一个意象，就是有很多就是小孩，然后他们就一直跟我要面包吃，然后我就一直就是拨面包给这些人，但是就是这些人他们都怎么讲？就他们看到我好像看到自己的母亲。然后在那个时候，我就跟神说：“好，主啊，如果你真的要我做这样子的事情的话，那你就开路吧。”
just imagine my life next to you every morning, every night, amen. It's more than a dream. We don't have to Skype. And I love this journey with God. Just like, it's so amazing how God told me, you're gonna be with her in the nations.
You always tell me, we cannot be inside of church. We have to go out and be the church. You have to live your life to the fullness. I remember one time I was asking God, if I'm asking for a husband, what kind of quality I should be looking for? And God told me, you have to find someone who loves me more than you do, and that's you.
踏上红毯 ，Ricardo 与 Justin 在众人的祝福下展开他们的新婚生活。这一对墨台异国恋曲是上帝亲自凑成对。一开始 ，Justin 的家人也对女儿的选择感到不解，不过到了婚礼这一天，都化为对这一对新人的期待与祝福。
这是我的属灵母亲 Heather Takuji 韩嘉欣，然后她在我五年前认识主的时候呢，她就像是我亲生妈妈一样，就是不断的带领我认识，让我更寻求神，然后也教导我。
When she met Ricardo, I had the privilege of taking Ricardo up to Reading to visit her one time.And it's 8 hours up and 8 hours back. So we had a really good time of this mama getting to know that guy because I wasn't too sure. Who is this Mexican that wants to get together with my friend? And
it's Valentine's Day.
Yeah, it was Valentine's Day. Oh, that's right. There was so much romance in it. It's just really exciting to watch what God's doing in and through him because he doesn't need anything. He doesn't need anybody to come alongside of him because he just knows that God's told him, do this, and so he is. And so because he's got that boldness, then God is bringing all these people alongside of him to go. And it's just fun to watch the two of them come together with such passion for Jesus and for the lost, and to go infect Tijuana, Mexico, and the nations.
生长在台湾一般传统信仰家庭的 Justin 接触到教会后，宣教士田口俊、韩信佳夫妇把他当作是女儿一般，带领他深入基督信仰。现在 Justin 透过绘画诉说着天父的话语，分享上帝的恩典。这个原本一心向往成为外交官的台湾女孩，去了美国，再踏入墨西哥，展开她的大冒险。
Ricardo 呢，虽然是一个墨西哥人，但是他跟台湾有特殊的连结。他是台湾女婿，今天他的太太 Justin 也一样来到我们现场，欢迎你。
你好。
因为我们刚才听到 Ricardo 讲了蛮多他自己从小这些信仰的过程跟经历，那像你自己的话，你们家庭的背景跟信仰也有关联吗？
我从小是在佛教徒的家庭长大，然后我大概在5年前才认识耶稣的。
那是什么样的机会去接触到福音呢？
就是我刚好有一个二姑姑，然后她在上海的灵粮堂当传道。
是，
然后他有一年呢，过年的时候，他邀请我去台北灵粮堂聚会，然后后来我就决定要就是决志认识耶稣。然后我记得那时候有一个晚上，我就做了一个梦，我就看到有红色的三个影子在抓我，然后我就把一些偶像的名字，就我小时候一直不断拜的一些偶像名字，就是喊出来。然后我就觉得没有人来救我，然后我就后来就说耶稣你是真的，你要来救我，然后就那个红色的那影子就消失了。
是。
然后我早上起床第一件事情，我就 Google 家里最近的一间教会，就是天母灵粮堂，然后我就那个就变成我的 home church 这样子。那当初的那边的主任牧师就是田口俊和那个韩嘉欣的 Jeff 和 Heather， 他们是我的属灵父母。对，然后他们一路这样带领我，然后做门徒训练，然后接下来就 送我去念伯特利的那个敬拜学院，这样。
哇，你好像到那个地方也有一些很特殊的经历。
第一年进去的时候，我们会分班级，然后班导就是他们叫做 Revival Group Pastor， 就每60个人会有一个班导。然后那时候班导他旁边有一些实习牧师，他们会牧养我们这些学生嘛。然后我的实习牧师就一直跟我讲说，你有一个恩膏，你要去救这些孤儿，还有一些弱势的团体。然后他说你会在一个非常就像是第三世界国家那样子的地方，穷乡僻壤。然后刚开始他们对我预言的时候，我就说这个预言我不要领受，我说我有别的打算。然后呢？
你那时候原来想要做什么？
我想要做外交官，那是我的梦想。哦，对，所以我就觉得说，那跟我觉得我自己的护照不一样。然后接下来的几天呢、啊，那个整个礼拜，学校有一些同学看到我就说，哎，你可能有那个。就是孤儿之母的那种恩膏，你认识 Heidi Baker 吗？我说我知道他，但是我觉得这跟孤儿之母，我觉得不要一些关联，因为我觉得我有别的打算。一直到学校参加的退休会，然后退休会的时候，每一个晚上都有敬拜之夜嘛。然后第一个晚上我就看到一个异象，就是我自己，然后我就拿了那个面包，然后有很多就是小孩，然后他们就一直跟我要面包吃。然后我就一直就是拨面包给这些人，但是就是这些人他们都怎么讲？就他们看到我好像看到自己的母亲。然后在那个时候，我就跟神说：“好，主啊，如果你真的要我做这样子的事情的话，那你就开路吧。”就那一天，我就觉得说我顺服神了，这样。
是是是、嗯，你在那里是主要念什么的？
我就是不会画画，所以我就选那个先知性艺术。
你不会画画，但你选艺术，
因为我觉得说要回本，然后所以我就觉得说，那我就选一个我完全不会的，也不熟悉。所以我记得我那时候选了先知性艺术，
像这个画就你画的，对不对？
对对对。这一幅画我会画的原因是，我回来台湾的时候，我就躺在床铺上祷告，我就问说神，我要画什么？他就说你要画单纯的喜乐，要倚靠耶和华，然后有单纯的喜乐。我说什么叫做单纯的喜乐？我不知道你在讲什么。然后就一直不断的祷告，然后祷告的时候，我有一个橱柜，然后都会放了一些明信片啊、照片，然后。这个我用的这个参考图片就是我以前同事，他刚好是去海地赈灾，然后就拍了这个小朋友照片，那是应该6年前的事情。然后我就问他说，我可不可以用这个参考图片画单纯的喜乐？然后他就问我说，你为什么会想要选这个图片？我就说，我因为我觉得神在告诉我，他要依靠他是单纯的喜乐。他就说，我觉得神在用你在跟我说话，所以我刚好也就是祝福到这一个摄影师这样。对。
那所谓先知性的艺术，它是一个什么样的事工内容啊？
其实就像是敬拜一样，通常有时候我们在敬拜当中，我们会透过音乐，我们会透过祷告，我们会透过各种方式。但是先知性艺术就是在敬拜当中呢，你就是。艺术的方式来呈现神的同在，
是是。
我们用先知性艺术可以做祷告，或者是用先知性艺术为人家祷告的医治预言。
不过想到你跟墨西哥的关联哦，一刚开始怎么会想要去墨西哥啊？
其实刚开始我不想去墨西哥，
刚开始不想去墨西哥，
因为。我不是说，就是那时候我祷告，就是神就跟我讲说，哦，你要去一个第三世界国家。我第一个想到的就是去莫桑比克，
非洲，
对非洲，因为我想说 Heidi Baker 在那边，然后我一方面我就是蛮崇拜他的，因为我觉得他真的很有很多的爱，所以我第一就是我们学校的宣教可以填5个志愿，我第一个志愿就填莫桑比克，然后大部分的国家都是非洲国家，最后一个我才填墨西哥。因为我觉得说，哎，我以前想考外交官，所以我学一点西语，可能有就是可以用得到。结果没想到就上了，就去墨西哥。我就觉得说，主啊，为什么我不能去莫桑比克？
所以去了那边做什么呢？刚开始，
我第一次不是去提花，然后第一次去的是墨西哥城，然后是我第一次看到瞎眼得着看见，所以我觉得神他一定在那个地方要让我经历他是有他的美意。
所以因为第一次有看到像这样神迹，后来就又再去了。
对。
So back to Ricardo, how did you meet Justin?
One time that I go to Raleigh District, she go to a mission trip there. And she's there painting, actually. Uh-huh. And for me, that's new. I never see like someone is painting in the church. It's new for me, that prophetic art. And she's the only Asian, and she's so beautiful. So I'm just looking like interesting, like, oh, she's making art, number one, and she's cute. That's it. And next day, I invite them to go and preach in my worship school. I used to have a worship school there too. And they go and she preach. And when she's preaching, the presence of the Holy Spirit is in the room, it's in the school. And God tell me, you're going to be in the nations with her.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I'm here.
So you start to go after her then?
Yes. I don't speak English. That's the funny part.
Uh-huh.
When I know her, I don't speak English.
So
I understand a little English, and she speaks more Spanish than why I speak English in that time.
Mm-hmm.
And I do my best. I say,
God,
tell me. So
how did you do to let her say yes?
I don't know. God is good.
所以他刚刚讲说他那时候还不会讲英文，
嗯，
然后在墨西哥讲西班牙文嘛，对不对？你会讲西班牙文吗？
我会讲一点西班牙语。
哦，所以你们主要的沟通方式
就是西班牙语加英语。
Uh-huh.
所以我们每一次在 Skype 在视讯的时候，就是我用我的破西班牙语，他用他的破英语。然后我们就让彼此能够了解。
那 Ricardo 刚刚讲说，因为神让他有那个感动，就是你这样子。嗯、那你这边呢？
那时候我在为他发预言的时候，我就会觉得，我有觉得说他蛮吸引我的。但是我觉得说这只是一趟短宣，没有，我觉得应该不会有什么发展，所以我就没有特别去想。
那后来嘞？
后来他就开始就是追求我啊，然后。我觉得很惊讶，
是，But you said you didn't speak English like mine.
How we do it?
Yeah, and you use English to preach now.
Yes, God is good.
So how were you able to do that?
I don't know. God is good. I don't know how to. Maybe it's in my mind, and I don't know it. I just start speaking English. Take me months, and she's maybe my teacher. She's so patient with me when I try to. Speak, she's have patience, and I don't know, maybe in 2 months, not maybe, in 2 months I'm preaching in English in a church in LA with her.
Mm-hmm.
A Chinese church.
Korean church, it's Korean.
Mm-hmm. So, Ricardo, that your work, your service in Tijuana is quite special there.
Hmm.
And actually, we really want to know more about the special part of this area, because we heard that in Mexico, most of the area is controlled by mafia.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
So is that the same situation in Tijuana too?
Yeah, of course. Tijuana is maybe the fourth or fifth city biggest in Mexico,
mm-hmm.
and is the biggest country in the world. Mm-hmm. So all the mafia, or we say narco, they're. Fighting for that plaza, we say, like, for that spot, for that city.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always been conflict so bad. And the mafia control everything in Mexico, control the government, control the police, control everything, in the economy even. So Tijuana is, that's why it's kind of highlight from another city's the situation. And I work in the Red Light District, so... that Red Light District, of course, is controlled from mafias. It's a lot of prostitution. It's a lot of deported people, like homeless in the Red Light District. Maybe orphans and broken people from different things, alcohol,
mm-hmm, drugs.
People who is like already lose their mind walking over there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.Is that because the Tijuana is just at the border of the Mexico and the U.S.?
Yes.
So Tijuana is quite complicated.
Yeah, it's like, that's why everybody want to cross to U.S. Right now, actually today, in the news is like, it's a lot, like 2,000 people from Africa is in Tijuana right now because they want to cross the border. So what happened is, I think they cannot cross the border with U.S., so they're going to stay in Tijuana. So now...In just 1 month, we have 2,000 like people from Africa living in Tijuana.
Oh, really?
Yeah, in the streets. That's the thing, because they don't have money. They don't have, so...
They have no place to go.
They don't have place to go. So that's happened normally with Latin America or Mexican people who be deported from U.S. to here, or they want a dream to go to U.S. and they never go and they stay in Tijuana.
Mm.
And yeah.
And lots of crime.
It's a lot. It's a lot of crime, but what I can tell you is different areas in Mexico, in Mexico and Tijuana too. Like, it's super rich people, like so secure, beautiful, so beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And another touristic, and next to the touristic is poor areas, and next to the poor is like relative street, and later again is a rich neighborhood, and it's like the difference of, it's now that you can say, oh, everything is crime, it's not true. It's only in one spot of this happen that things. And the other is so calm, the other is so tourist, the other is just malls. It's different. But it is a lot of crime.
And you mentioned about that the police is kind of controlled by the mafia too.
Yeah.
So police cannot do
it. Police, army, everything is controlled by mafia.
So no one can protect people?
If you are not in the mafia, you're safe.
Oh.
If you're in the mafia, you're gonna have short life normally. But if you are not doing nothing with the mafia or fighting with mafia or something in his business, you don't have no problem. You can live free, safe, like normal. And he tell me, he do a question and I do the same question to everybody. He tell me, how you gonna feel if you lose your son? And you have a lot of friends and you tell him, I lose my son, help me to find him. And everybody tell you, oh, I gonna pray for your son. Oh yeah, yeah, I gonna help you to find it. But then no one's go and try to find your kid. And I'm pretty sure I've just tell you the story and you already have compassion in your heart.
如果我相信你今天听到这故事，你开始已经对这个人有怜悯。
Do you?
你有没有觉得有怜悯了？
四处分享在提瓦纳的工作，更激励众人起身帮助他人。Ricardo 从一个无人在乎的穷小子，成为上帝忠心的使者，也成为许多人的帮助者。2014年5月 ，Ricardo 成立了他的小教会，会有只有他的妈妈及兄弟姐妹。到现在，每一次出门，带着食物、鲜花、卡片等等，帮助许许多多的人。他说，他现在仍然不知道钱从哪里来，但上帝不曾让他缺乏，并让他经验许多次上帝的真实。
其实我们在国际新闻当中都会看到墨西哥有的时候呢，这黑帮势力大到是真的感觉起来，你只要去抵抗它，你就会失去生命，非常危险。所以当他们在提瓦纳这个地方来做一些服饰的时候，有一些红线是你真的没有办法越线的，一旦越线就会带来极大极大的危险在这里头。So Ricardo, your ministry in the Red Light District, are those sex workers, are they the local people?
Oh no.They come from the south, and they're kind of like sex trafficking, human trafficking, and they put it work in the streets.
So what you're doing is to try to rescue them
Rescue in the name of Jesus, and I mean, we love them, we accept the way they are, and we give it opportunity in the spiritual.I don't try to say that, oh, don't worry, come with me, come, say, run away. No,
you cannot do that.
No way. So what we do is just go and love the girls. Like, we go and say, you know, you are precious for God. God loves you. We bring in roses, for example. We go and give a rose, like, this is for you. And the rose means that God loves you. And when you see the rose, just remember that God loves you so much. And that's it. We are praying for you. You're not alone here. We are praying for you. Our team are praying for you. Our church are praying for you. Have a nice day. And we continue. So the mafia, they're like that because we go and bless them. And we bless for finances. We always pray for finances. We pray for finances for you and your family in the south. So they are so touched. A lot of girls, they accept Jesus in the heart. Some of them, they want to find a way to go back to the family and left their life because God, the devil already... making kind of slaves. They think they cannot do another thing. But we try to break that and tell them, you know, you're a woman, you have dreams, you have to fight for your dreams, you have to go back with your child or with your family. Like, you can do it. And they're like, the Holy Spirit start convict them. And we go and talk with them and they're, sometimes they tell, you know, I really don't want to be here anymore. just want to laugh here. Like, I'm not comfortable doing this anymore.
And I believe you heard lots of sad stories too.
A lot of sad stories?
Yeah.
About
the change.
Change? Yeah. I have a lot. Alex, he grew up in a broken family in US. Mm-hmm. They're illegal from Mexico to US.
Oh, yeah?
The family, the mother is single and he lived with his two sisters. Mm-hmm. When the mother go to work, his boyfriend raped his sisters.
Oh.
He just have 3 years old.
Oh my God.
He grew up like that for a couple years. And he say, when I start going out to the streets, I see the gangs, you know, the mafia in the streets in the corner. I say, I want to be like them because everybody respect them. Mm-hmm. When I grow up, I want to be with them and I want a revenge of this guy. All that angry, that like rage. And he just want to be in troubles all the time. And he be in jail, he go out, he do drugs, he all kind of drugs. Later he be deported in US, to Mexico. So even he's from Mexico, he don't speak Spanish anymore because he live all his life in US. He cannot have any job because he don't have a paper, even a birth certificate, because he is no one, even in US or here. His family is in US, he cannot see his family anymore. And he start to be a kind of homeless, but he joined a gang of the homeless. Mm-hmm. And when we know him, he don't even shower for like maybe 10 or 11 months.
Months.
So you can tell
almost 1 year.
when you see him,
the smell.
Imagine, like he don't care because he don't care about life.
Yeah, right.
That's the thing. So whatever, that's what happened. He's like, we know him, God changed him, and he's totally like seeking God. He shower. So he start to dress different and he start to try to find God. And he's so smart, even he used a lot of drugs, his mind is complete. So what happened one night, he called me in the middle of the night and he tell me, you know, finally I give opportunity to God, my life changed. And he's in rehab in that moment. And he said, I go back to be in the streets, I'm hungry, I'm cold. And they tell me I have HIV. And I'm like, what you mean? And he said, yeah, you know, I just gonna buy a lot of drugs and I gonna suicide myself tonight. And I say, like, where are you? Don't do anything. And I go, I take some jackets, I bring some money, we go to eat, I give the jacket and I start talking to him. And I tell him, if you believe God gonna heal you, he gonna heal you from this, because you know where you come from. And God, he chose you, your love, his love, his mercy, and he gonna do it. I see miracles and you see miracles. You have to believe it. That maybe happened in October or something like that, or Agosto. So we praying for him every day, but nothing happened. And February, I'm praying for him one time and I'm praying for him. I put my hand here and his stomach start to jump. I feel everything warm, hot. My hand is hot and his stomach start to jump like poof, poof, poof. And I put another hand in the same place and I move later my hand here and this part of his start jumping too, jumping. And I'm like kind of scared but happy, like, oh. So we continue praying after that, and 2 days later he come and say, you know, I go to the people who help me to help the homeless who have the problem of HIV. They give a medicine, things like that. They do the test and he's negative of HIV.
Wow.
That guy preached to one guy, the transvestite that I raised, just tell you. He's a transvestite in drugs, prostitute. This guy preached to that guy. And with this guy come with us, he's a man now. They're friends, like now they're.
Okay.
So good.
Justin, 我们刚刚听了他讲的那个，哇，真的很感人故事。然后在那边到底做了什么样的服侍？不过确实服侍对象很特别，尤其是一些性工作者。身为一个女生，请刚到那边去，会不会有一些心理上的冲击？看到那里的状况。
我第一次去是跟 Bethel 专门服侍性工作者的团队的 leader 一起去。到了短宣，就是到达那个红灯区的时候，我一看了我就心都凉一半，我就想说我不太敢出去。可是当我们去为这些性工作者传福音的时候，我看到他们的有很多女孩是，你跟他讲说耶稣的事情，他是就是不愿意看你的脸，因为他们觉得很羞耻。然后在我的里面，我就觉得说，心又觉得说，天哪，他们就是长得这么漂亮，然后你跟他讲耶稣，他们就会不敢看你的眼睛。就是那时候我就觉得有感动，我就觉得说，如果我能够帮助他们有多好。然后后来我就改变我的策略，我每次去的时候，我都会画很多，做很多先知性艺术的卡片。
然后我只要跟他一起去传福音的时候，我一定会带卡片，然后我后面会写一些就是话语来鼓励他们。有时候不只是给性工作者，有时候也会给他们的皮条客，或者是给一些流浪汉街友，然后为他们祷告。有一次我们去就是也是去宣教，然后我们给那些就是那些性工作者这些卡片，然后我们就是在那些街区就是祷告啊，然后我们再绕回来的时候，那些女孩就会跟我们招手，就说我们还有带着这个卡片，然后一直跟我们招手。然后只要我每次去的时候，他们就很远看到我们，就会跟我们摇手，就是已经认识我们，然后很希望我们能够为他们祷告。
And I heard that you had a very special experience from God in July.
It's people who be connected with me from IHOP. That for a random way they call me and they.We do like appointment. They come to Tijuana to do a training to us from working in the Red Light District. That day, the training is going to start. It's already start. When I get late, I start to translate, and I'm translating about the training, you know, like about sex trafficking, that things. And I'm translating with this ear, and God starts speaking to me in this ear. Mm-hmm. And God starts telling me, like, Ricardo, thank you for listening to my voice.Thank you for love, my lost child. And I start be like now, like broken, and like I cannot speak very well. He just tell me like, really, I just love your heart because you listen my word. And he tell me, he do a question and I do the same question to everybody. He tell me, how you gonna feel if you lose your son? And you have a lot of friends and you tell him, I lose my son, help me to find him. And everybody tell you,Oh, I'm gonna pray for your son. Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm gonna help you to find it, but then no one's go and try to find your kid. In that time, I cannot even speak, so I tell to another lady that you can translate for me, and I go out to the building and the street, and I'll be my knees, totally my knees and my face in the ground, and I'm crying and crying and crying, and God tell me, I'm gonna show you my heart. This is my heart for my lost. And I feel such emptiness.Sadness, God is crying. Mm-hmm. Like God is crying for his last child. And he tell me this is the way that I feel every day for my last child. And I'm just crying. I'm so wet. And I'm crying so bad. And let me act a little bit. I'm just screaming like this in the street. I never scream like that. But I'm like, so bad. And I don't even
think. On the street?
Sorry?
On the street,
in the sidewalk. I'm just crying. I cannot stop myself because I feel so emptiness. I feel the heart of God. And we always see, oh, the heart of God is love and everything is love. But it's a lot of emptiness. He's sad because he wants someone to go and love his lost sons. And later, this girl, she's in my church. She's the best evangelist that we have in the church. She just had 4 years old. She's so beautiful. She's walking around so curious because I'm crying and screaming in the street. He's from my church. And she come and say, like, look at me. And she's just around. And later, she just come. I'm in my knees like this. And I'm so wet. Oh, even the floor is wet. And this kid come. And she just come and touch my with his mouth.Hand touch my leg and say, you're covered of the blood of Jesus. You're covered of the blood of Jesus. And when she starts saying that, all that sadness, all that heaviness is gone. And it's just peace. And it's like maybe, I don't know how many, maybe a minute or something. I'm just breathing and like so released. And God starts speaking to me again. And he say, this is all you need.You are covered of the blood of Jesus. It's the biggest symbol of love in the world, in the history, what Jesus do for us. And you are covered of all that mercy. You are covered of all the love. You are covered of all the blood of Jesus. You don't need nothing else. You already covered that. And he said, don't fear of the mafia. Don't fear of no one.
God will protect you.
Because you are covered of the blood of Jesus. Just like the Egypt, Moses put that in their candles. So,God tell me, don't be fear of that because you're covered of the blood of Jesus. And he say, for the what you need for do this work is the blood of Jesus and you're covered of the blood of Jesus. What means the blood of Jesus? He means all the power that you need, all the miracles, all the forgiveness, you already have it. You are totally carrying that. You have everything you need to do this work. So I come back to the meeting and I start preaching everybody in Espanol and English, la, la, la. Everybody's crying on the floor. And it's a beautiful, beautiful experience for me particular and for my team and for the guests that we have that day. I think it's so special how God is seeking for his last child.
At the end of this interview, do you have more want to share with our audience?
I bless you. I honor you. I honor your country. Thank you for the opportunity, for the invitation. For me, it's so incredible that, you know, another country, like, for me, it's like, I just do it for free. I don't care if no one is there looking at me, like, I don't care. I just want to do what Jesus do. And there's someone from another country, another continent, another language, they want to hear the story about what God doing in my country. Mm-hmm. It's an honor. It's like how God put me in here. For me, my verse of the Bible is, you be faithful in the small things and I'm going to give you more. You know, like, I don't know how to translate it. In Espanol is different, but that's the meaning. I always be faithful with the small things, with no one, with nothing. God always give more, always.
那 Justin 呢？你自己其实你说你是五年多前才开始接触了信仰，可是这短短五年的时间已经经历了这么多事情了。在最后有没有特别想要跟我们观众朋友来做点最后分享的部分？
祷告的时候不要一直求说，主啊，我的应许在哪里？你已经在你的应许里面，可能神对于你跟你讲的一句话，一个方向，你可能是觉得非常的模糊，但是你真的要勇敢的去尝试，勇敢的去做，不要因为金钱或者是资源，然后来决定你未来的方向。你一定要听神的声音，做每一件事情。
所以我真的在你身上，我看到是一个对神非常单纯的爱，就是像 Ricardo 讲的，他就是想要为神去做这么简单。因为耶稣怎么样的去救这些穷人，救这些在困苦当中的人，他就是单纯的也想要这么做而已。我相信未来在你们的服事工作上，神也是大大祝福你们。谢谢 ，Thank you for your sharing. Thank you.
Thank you.
谢谢。
神迹对许多人来说是生命当中一次特别的经历，但是对基督徒而言，神迹则是上帝在我们一生当中工作的痕迹。在今天我们听见 Ricardo 牧师从墨西哥来，听见他们夫妇的服事，我不知道对你来说印象最深刻的地方在哪里。我想对很多人来说，如果有选择可以移民，那个选项应该是在富裕繁荣安全的地方，但是我们发现上帝的带领好奇妙，上帝将从台湾去的 Justin 师母带到了 Ricardo 牧师和他一同服侍的合场，这一切都是来自于上帝的爱。在他们的分享里，让我想到耶稣在他生命当中曾经遇过的故事，就是有一次当耶稣经过了一个大大的树下，那这个大大的树下上面有了一个矮矮的身影。当耶稣要去到耶利哥的过程当中，有一个个子不太高的人，他的生命是有故事的，就像是我们刚刚听见墨西哥的牧者他所服侍的对象一样。而这些故事常常让那些被遗忘就在树上的那一个人，我们说撒该，他有了一个很真实的心情，那个心情就是，我是不配得的，或许我远远观看就可以了。而这一对牧师夫妇他们所做的服事，正是把耶稣的爱带到了最不配得，从世人的眼光来看最被遗忘的一群人身上。或许对我们来说，我们的经历和墨西哥的经历和 Ricardo 牧师夫妇他们所服事的对象截然不同，也跟圣经故事里面有一个很不讨喜的角色叫做撒该很不一样，因为他们有他们的故事，我们有我们的故事。但坦白说，我们也有我们的隐藏，我们也有我们觉得我们应该不配得这样的爱吧，我们应该不需要有耶稣这么特别的款待吧。而正是在 Ricardo 牧师夫妇的服事里，我们看见配得，我们看见耶稣的爱就是要临到许许多多的拒绝，或者说许许多多的自我否定。当我们在成长的旅程里，我们不一定遭受到这么特别的际遇，像是黑帮、毒品等等的问题，但是我们可能不认为自己配得完全的尊荣， 我们也不认为自己可以领受到那一位天上的上帝来到我生命当中一个极深的服事。但亲爱的朋友，在今天我们要跟你分享这个耶稣的爱，耶稣的爱来到你的生命里，就是要对我们每一个自我放弃甚至自我放逐的生命，他对我们说，我爱你，我为你钉在十字架上，我诚心的邀请你跟我一起来做一个祷告，接受耶稣做你生命的主。亲爱的耶稣，谢谢你，你为这一个不完全的我来到世上，不论我生命的际遇如何，你已经为我钉在十字架上，你用你坚定不移的爱要解决我生命里头自我放逐的问题。愿你透过今天 Ricardo 牧师夫妇的见证，让我经历到，让我听见你对我生命毫无保留的爱。同心祷告，奉耶稣基督的名求，阿们。耶稣爱你，透过十字架的工作向你显明，深愿你能够领受耶稣基督的爱。